Good evening. I'm Judy Woodruff on the NewsHour tonight. At the extreme, a blistering heat wave hangs over California, straining the power grid and raising alarm about the effects of climate change. Then, vote 2022. We examine the closest Senate races ahead of the November election as Republicans and Democrats battle for control of Congress. And the invasion's impact. Ukrainian Holocaust survivors are forced to flee war once again as Russian attacks grind on.
If you had asked us a year ago if we thought that there would be an evacuation of Holocaust survivors from the Ukraine to Germany, we would have laughed. No one would have imagined it.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us.
CFO. Caregiver. Eclipse Chaser. A Raymond James financial advisor tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
The Walton Family Foundation. Working for solutions to protect water during climate change so people and nature can thrive together. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. This has been another scorching day across much of the American West. Utility operators in California issued a new statewide alert urging consumers to conserve electricity. The state avoided blackouts on Tuesday despite energy demands hitting an all-time high. We'll take a closer look right after the news summary. In Saskatchewan, Canada, tonight, the final suspect in the stabbing deaths of 10 people has died from self-inflicted wounds. That's according to a Canadian official. The suspect, Miles Sanderson, had disappeared after Sunday's attacks at the Cree Nation Reserve and the village of Weldon in Saskatchewan, which also wounded 18. His younger brother, Damien, also a suspect, was found dead earlier this week at the reserve. Russia's President Vladimir Putin is defying pressure to halt the war in Ukraine and insisting Moscow will forge ahead. He spoke today at a forum in Vladivostok and mocked Western sanctions. Instead, he said Russia's economy has weathered the worst.
I'm sure that we have not lost anything and will not lose anything. When it comes to the gains, I can say that the main one is the strengthening of our sovereignty. Everything that keeps us from moving forward will be abandoned. We will gain momentum, as will the pace of development.
Putin also threatened to cut off energy supplies to Europe if the European Union imposes a price cap on Russian natural gas. Meanwhile, in Ukraine, shelling resumed near the Russian-controlled Zaporizhia nuclear power plant. The UN nuclear agency called Tuesday for a protection zone around the site. On the pandemic, the World Health Organization reports new COVID infections fell 12% worldwide last week. But in China, 65 million people are now under lockdowns as the government enforces its zero COVID policy. That includes 21 million in Chengdu, where authorities kept people in their apartments even during an earthquake on Monday. Back in this country, a Michigan judge ruled today that a 1931 state law criminalizing most abortions is unconstitutional. That decision upholds a previous order barring the enforcement of the law. The ruling comes as the Michigan Supreme Court must decide by Friday whether to place a proposed amendment on the November 8th ballot that would add abortion rights to the state constitution. The governor's race is set in Massachusetts after another primary win by a Trump-endorsed candidate. Jeff Deal defeated a more moderate Republican on Tuesday and will face Democrat Maura Healey in November. Healey is favored to flip the seat in favor of Democrats and become the state's first openly gay governor and the first woman elected to the office. The Obamas were back in the White House today to unveil their official portraits. The former president and first lady pulled back coverings to show their likenesses. And Michelle Obama appeared to tie the ceremony to former President Trump's rejection of the 2020 election results.
Traditions like this matter, not just for those of us who hold these positions, but for everyone participating in and watching our democracy. You see, the people, they make their voices heard with their vote. We hold an inauguration to ensure a peaceful transition of power.
Former President Obama's portrait is by Robert McCurdy. Mrs. Obama's was painted by Sharon Sprung. Public schools in Seattle canceled their first day of school today in the face of a teacher's strike. The walkout centers on demands for higher pay, mental health support, and better teacher-pupil staffing ratios for special education. Contract negotiations are continuing as school administrators announce schools will remain closed on Thursday. And former NPR foreign correspondent Ann Garrels has died after fighting lung cancer. She joined NPR in 1988 after working for ABC and NBC News. Over the years, she covered conflicts in Chechnya, Bosnia, Afghanistan, and the Middle East. And she was one of a handful of Western journalists who reported live from Baghdad during the 2003 Iraq War. Ann Garrels was 71 years old. Still to come on the NewsHour, tennis legend Chris Evert reflects on her career and her battle with ovarian cancer. Holocaust survivors fleeing Russia's invasion of Ukraine find safe harbor in an unexpected place. The Smithsonian Institution and the U.S. Army join forces to save art around the world, and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour. From WETA Studios in Washington, and in the West, from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The record-setting heat wave of the past few days has pushed California to the brink, with the state facing its highest chance of rolling blackouts this year. Stephanie Tsai has the latest.
Another searing day baking California. The state's power grid operator urged residents to conserve energy for an eighth day straight. Demand for electricity last night broke a Golden State record, threatening widespread power losses and rolling blackouts that were narrowly avoided. Residents found shade wherever they could get it.
I think a lot of people using the air conditioner, like, and using light, fans, you know, everything just to try to keep, like, you know, cool.
We seem to always just make it through. We have our little tricks to keep cool. Everybody does.
At the Orange County Zoo, zookeepers gave animals blocks of ice to stay cool.
Oh, you get that.
Temperatures surpassed 110 degrees in many parts of the state this week. Sacramento reached a 97-year high at 116. Earlier this month, California's Death Valley set a new record at 127 degrees. It was the planet's hottest recorded September day. Scientists say climate change has fueled these more intense, longer summers and led to more frequent, raging wildfires. The sprawling Fairview fire outside Los Angeles broke out this week and is only 5% contained.
And the risk for outages is real and it's immediate.
Last night, Governor Gavin Newsom urged people to save power and spoke of a brutal month to come.
In fact, this heat wave is on track to be both the hottest and the longest on record for the state and many parts of the West for the month of September.
Indeed, other parts of the West are under the heat dome, including Salt Lake City, Utah, which recorded its hottest September day since the late 19th century this week, and alarmingly low water levels at the Great Salt Lake.
Temperatures may not moderate in many places until Friday.
Let's focus on the concern over potential outages in California, the energy grid, and what's being done to deal with the demands of the moment. For that, I'm joined by Catherine Blunt, who covers renewable energy and utilities at the Wall Street Journal. She's also the author of the new book, California Burning, The Fall of Pacific Gas and Electric and What It Means for America's Power Grid. Catherine Blunt, thank you so much for joining the NewsHour. I was reading, you know, that last night, California's Office of Emergency Services actually sent out an urgent text message telling electricity customers they needed to conserve energy now or risk outages. Are those kind of alerts working to manage demand, and are they enough to prevent the power grid from faltering?
Well, I think that's the million-dollar question. There was a lot of voluntary conservation last night, which certainly helped keep the situation from going over the edge. It was very close. The grid operator called a certain level of an emergency that was just, you know, hair's width away from having to call for rolling outages. So it was tight, and that conservation helped. But of course, we are on watch for the rest of the week.
California seems to have an energy crisis every summer. Why is that, Catherine? Haven't there been improvements made to make the grid more reliable and resilient? There were numerous rolling blackouts that we saw in 2020. Have things improved?
Yeah, so there's been a convergence of a number of different things that have influenced these circumstances. For one, we are seeing more severe heat waves across the entire region, across California and throughout the West, exacerbated by climate change, and that makes it so that electricity demand during these periods of time is really very high. And this is ultimately a question of keeping levels of demand and supply in balance, because if there is an imbalance, you risk wider system breakdown. So that's why sometimes there's been the need for rolling blackouts to keep those levels in balance. Of course, California has been consumed by a severe drought. Hydroelectric power generation has been constrained. And during these westwide heat waves, it becomes harder for California to import power on an emergency basis. And of course, you know, there's been a rapid shift to wind and solar power over the last several years, which makes managing supply levels at the time when solar production begins to ramp down especially challenging. So that's why you see some of these crunches in the summers.
Could any of this have been avoided? I mean, you go through a lot of the complex factors that lead to the strain on energy. All day, again, for the eighth day in a row, we have been hearing the grid operator warn of these rolling outages that are extremely disruptive to hundreds of thousands of Californians every year.
The grid operators had to take increasingly drastic measures to help manage these supply challenges in recent summers. That's meant relying on more gas-fired power generators. Just recently, the state legislature moved to keep the state's last nuclear power plant online. It had been set to retire in the coming years, and now it looks like it'll run for quite some time longer. And so it's been the grid operators had to look for more and more places for additional power.
California has been very aggressive in embracing renewable, more green energy sources. And yet every summer, again, we see these energy shortages. You have reported, Catherine, on how other states are also looking at potential energy crises as climate change means hotter summers, more people needing more air conditioning. What can be learned from observing California's transition to renewables and how that can impact energy supply during times of great demand?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, I think at its core, this is a timing challenge. It has become challenging to navigate the near-term transition because, of course, you know, wind and solar power, the production fluctuates with weather and fluctuates with time of day, which makes it a bit more challenging for grid operators to make sure that there's always adequate supplies. And in California, you see that most acutely, you know, after 4 p.m. when solar production begins to decline. Proponents of the transition, which of course is well underway, believe that there's the appropriate technology to be able to deal with this in the future as we add more battery storage to store wind and solar power for use when production declines. But one additional challenge that we're seeing here in the near term is that there's been supply chain issues, inflationary pressures, and other things that have made it more difficult to bring these projects online in a timely fashion. So it looks that like the next several years are going to be difficult across a number of different regions that are in the middle of this transition. But there's, you know, there's reason to believe that longer term, we'll be able to sort through some of these many challenges.
One of your focuses has been the focus on wildfires in California and how that is further straining the energy grid every summer and the role that companies like PG&E play. How much are those issues playing into the strain on the grid we're seeing this week?
Sure. So when you think about wildfires and how it affects the balance of supply and demand, big fires can constrain transmission capacity, which makes it harder to move power from point A to point B, adding an additional challenge for the grid operator and making sure that there's adequate supply everywhere. There was a transmission emergency yesterday and the day before up in Northern California, likely associated with some of PG&E's power lines. Details aren't exactly clear as to what exactly the problem was, but emergency generation was needed to offset some of the constraints on those lines. So I don't think it was fire related, but it may have been heat related. So there's all kinds of things that can go wrong in the transport of power that make this more difficult.
Every year, such a confluence of crises we're seeing there in California. Catherine Blunt, author of the new book, California Burning, and Wall Street Journal reporter, thank you for joining the NewsHour.
Thank you very much for having me. I appreciate it.
The midterm election season is now in full swing, and both parties are vying for control over what is currently an evenly divided Senate. Right now, Democrats hold 48 seats, plus the two independent senators who caucus with the Democratic Party, while Republicans hold 50 seats. This year's 36th Senate midterm contest could change that balance of power. Following this all so closely is Jessica Taylor of the Cook Political Report with Amy Walter. Jessica, welcome back to the NewsHour. Yesterday we looked at the House. We're going to look at the Senate now. So here we are, 2 months out. What does the Senate look like?
It looks much better for Democrats than many Democrats that I talked to ever thought that it would. You know, we see historically in a president's first midterm election, their party loses about an average of two seats each midterm cycle. And what we have seen, though, I would have put Republican chances at taking back the Senate because, again, they only need one seat. Right. At about 60 to 65% chance this spring when you had rising gas prices, inflation, when you had Biden's approval ratings that were in the mid-30s. I mean, all of this felt like it was just going to be, you know, a tsunami, perhaps. Question was, how high could Republicans go? Could they pick up four or five seats even? But now what we have seen is a tightening overall of the national landscape that is reflected in the House, but especially in the Senate. With, again, gas prices have gotten better, the Biden White House and congressional Democrats passed the Inflation Reduction Act, semiconductor bill, and also that key decision that came down at the end of June that sent Roe v. Wade back to the states. That has animated a lot of women voters that are especially registering right now. We've seen this enthusiasm gap that Republicans have been able to capitalize on early in the cycle, but now Democrats are closing it. And in the Senate, candidates matter more. Mm-hmm. I was skeptical too at the beginning of the cycle because we've seen Senate races become so parliamentary almost, where voters are voting for a party, not necessarily a candidate. And that's, again, how I, all things considered, when we look at historical midterms, that's what I would expect it to have happened. But you have Republicans that have nominated really some weak, problematic candidates.
So the abortion decision by the Supreme Court has energized Democrats, you're saying. But as you say, these candidates, specifically the ones endorsed by former President Trump, you're seeing that is having an impact on some of these races.
I mean, I've talked with Republicans over the past month that have been working in some of these Senate races for years, and they are just, you know, so worried because they're like, we're going to snatch defeat from the jaws of victory, really. Because had we nominated more traditional type candidates and not the Trump endorsed candidates that he sort of got in and meddled with, really, often throwing his weight behind the more controversial candidate, these races could have looked a lot different. So will Republicans on election night be thinking, you know, woulda, coulda, shoulda?
So you're talking about states like Pennsylvania, like Ohio, like Arizona?
Yeah, so Pennsylvania is one actually where we had this in toss-up and we moved it a few weeks ago to lean Democrats. So this is an open seat that Republicans hold. So Republicans aren't even, they're having to play defense right now. That's the number one seat that we see could possibly flip.
Looking at Mehmet Oz, mm-hmm. who's the Trump-endorsed Republican.
Yeah, I mean, he came out of a very brutal primary. He had Trump's endorsement, but his approval ratings in the state are underwater, and he's someone who's pretty well known. And you had John Fetterman, who despite, I mean, he faces real questions about his health after—
The Democrat.
Right, mm-hmm. The lieutenant governor after he suffered a stroke on the eve of the election. He's just now getting back out to campaigning and things, but he has very high people. I've even heard Republicans say, you know, he seems more authentic to a lot of people because remember Dr. Oz even had been living in New Jersey and moved to Pennsylvania for this race.
So there are four states in particular you had singled out to mm-hmm. us that you're particularly paying close attention to, closely contested. These are Arizona, Georgia, North Nevada, and Wisconsin.
Yeah, so three of those are Democratic held, and these should be the top targets for Republicans, really. These are all states that Biden won by under 3 points in all of them. And Arizona, Mark Kelly is outpacing where Biden's numbers are in the state. We would see typically a good run would be 3 to 5 points ahead of where your party's president would be. But Kelly's outperforming by 7 points. Fetterman's outperforming by 9 points. And you have a really controversial candidate here in Blake Masters. He worked for Peter Thiel, the former PayPal billionaire. Mm-hmm. And he has a lot of baggage, things that he wrote in college, sympathizing with the Unabomber and favorably quoting a Nazi leader. So these are all things. You're also seeing McConnell's super PAC cut money from this race. So this is a race that could Democrats, you know, could
That's
Republicans
Arizona.
Be?
Right. And then Georgia with Herschel Walker.
Yeah, so also like Mark Kelly, Herschel Walker just won in a special election, having to run again. He's raising a ton of money, but actually so is Herschel Walker. Walker, of course, the former Heisman Trophy winner for the University of Georgia. Trump really got him into this race. He won the primary, I think, many reasons, not Trump being alone. I mean, he's a football hero in the state, but he's lagging behind. And we could actually see, though, in the governor's race there, Brian Kemp is running ahead. Could he sort of help Herschel Walker over the goal line, if you will?
And we should clarify, it was Raphael Warnock who won in that
yes.
in that special election. But just very quickly, only a minute, you've got Nevada with another Trump-endorsed.
Yeah.
Candidate.
Adam Laxalt, though, is not as problematic as some of these. He's more of a generic Republican. He was former attorney general. And then in Wisconsin, Ron Johnson is the most endangered Senate Republican. He's behind in polling with the Lieutenant Governor Mandela Barnes there, having just won the nomination. Johnson's approval ratings are very low for an incumbent as well. And, you know, he's someone that's managed to hang on in tough election cycles before. So could we see this one tighten? I mean, these could all go either way. We still see the Senate overall as a toss-up, but it's a much better environment for Democrats with 2 months to go than many of them had anticipated.
Just fascinating. One really interesting race, closely fought in state after state. Mm-hmm. Jessica Taylor with the Cook Political Report. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Judy.
Millions of people have fled the war in Ukraine, among them hundreds of elderly Holocaust survivors. They are becoming refugees once again as they near the end of their lives. More than 80 have been rescued in special evacuations, sponsored by a collaboration of international organizations. And as Nick Schifrin discovered, some are finding refuge in a most unlikely place. This story is done in partnership with Retro Report, the WNET Group's Exploring Hate Initiative, and the Pulitzer Center.
In the early days of the Russian invasion, with bombs and uncertainty raining, millions of Ukrainians scrambled for safety. They fled their homes, hoping to escape to neighboring countries. And along the way, many stopped in Rabbi Moshe Osman's Kyiv synagogue. 92-year-old Rahel Entina worried about her nephew and grandson, who stayed behind.
We don't know what will happen to them. These Russians, please tell me, how can they have no shame? How can they have no shame?
One person who managed to escape with her daughter, Larissa Pogosova.
It was scary when we were traveling through Ukraine. I had only seen these sort of things in movies. I felt anxiety and fear that we were in danger.
They secured a coveted spot on an evacuation bus to Moldova with other Ukrainian families. And for the second time, Entina was forced to leave Ukraine and become a refugee. In 1941, her family fled the Nazi army.
Me, my mother, grandmother, and my twin sister, we left on a train, but no one told us anything about where we were going. There were people left in Babi Yar.
Babi Yar, this ravine here in Kyiv. In September 1941, the Nazis seized this city, and over a 36-hour period, Nazi soldiers marched tens of thousands of Ukrainian Jews here, killed them with machine gun fire, and dumped them in a mass grave.
That was one of the first large-scale massacres of Jews in World War II. During the war, German troops and local collaborators killed 1.5 million Ukrainian Jews, gunning them down in fields and ravines in what is known as the Holocaust by bullets. This year, many Holocaust survivors feared for their safety. Their lives became bookended by war.
These Holocaust survivors, these Jews, were abandoned by the world as children. As the Nazis were coming for them, to murder them, and they had to flee, and so we had to rescue them.
Greg Schneider heads the Claims Conference, which provides financial assistance to Holocaust survivors. They partnered with the Jewish aid agency, the Joint Distribution Committee, to call thousands of survivors. Pini Moretsky arranged medical evacuations for survivors who were in ailing health or unable to get out on their own.
How can you explain to a person who is maybe frightened at 80 plus or 90 years old, they need to leave their homes?
Evacuating the elderly during a war requires a small army of supplies and people.
And additional food.
Like the Claims Conference's Rudiger Malo.
You had to evacuate them with an ambulance because they were so fragile. So where do you get an ambulance? In a country of war where 90% of the ambulances are confiscated by the army.
Among the Holocaust survivors needing medical attention was Samuil Slobodsky. Early in the war, he insisted on staying. But in June, during a moment of calm, he decided he needed to escape. He brought only himself and his sense of humor. How do you feel? The driver asks.
Age appropriate, 85 and then some.
Slobodsky faced a host of medical conditions and traveled by ambulance across Ukraine with a doctor.
We will take 2 stops, possibly 3, depending on the state of the patient. Then the next crew will take him to Dusseldorf.
Dusseldorf, Germany, may seem like the last place to evacuate a survivor of Hitler's genocide. But nursing homes across the country opened their doors to Holocaust survivors with the support of German President Frank-Walter Steinmeier.
If you had asked us a year ago if we thought that there would be an evacuation of Holocaust survivors from the Ukraine to Germany, we would have laughed. No one would have imagined it.
How should you communicate it to the survivor? We will evacuate you to a country that over 75 years ago was persecuting you and wanted you to be dead. It was not an easy sell.
I somehow believed it would be okay. On the journey, I was scared of what was going on around me. I was shaking on the way.
Tatiana Zhuravlyova and Larisa Zhuyenko were evacuated from Kyiv in March. After 26 hours of travel, they finally arrived in Frankfurt. They now live in this nursing home and share a room and memories of escape from the Nazis.
My mother was Jewish.
My mother was Jewish, and my father was a journalist. He said that the Germans don't love the Jews, so you all need to go away. And he sent us to Uzbekistan.
I was 2 years old when the war started. What they told me was that I climbed under the table and said to my mother, "Let's get in the hole." So I already knew that there were some kind of bomb shelters where you needed to hide in.
One out of every 4 victims of the Holocaust who died on what is the terrain of Ukraine today.
Historian Wendy Lauer has been studying the Ukrainian Holocaust for 3 decades.
The Holocaust in Ukraine occurred in a way that was incredibly rapid. a direct assault that was perpetrated primarily in a kind of military-style so-called security operations, which were mass shootings and mobile gas vans. We've discovered at least 1,000 mass murder sites.
In 1941, we fled from the Germans. Now we faced war once more, and now we've come to the Germans so they will protect us. This is the paradox. So maybe there is no such thing as permanent friends or permanent enemies.
As for Larissa Pogosova, she is now living near Frankfurt, but without her mother, Rahel. A week after they arrived safely in Germany, Rahel died of COVID-19.
Every day, in the evening, I think I must call mom. And it's difficult for me, very difficult.
These two-time refugees who were hesitant to leave their homes have been surprised by the community they found in the birthplace of the Nazi Party. And despite her grief, Pogosova, too, says she's grateful for the warm welcome she received in Germany, as is Zoravlyova.
Everyone received us so warmly and paid a lot of attention to us from the first day. I don't feel like I'm in Germany as a guest of the Germans, but rather that I'm here among my own people.
Yet many still want to return to Ukraine, just as they did after World War II.
As soon as the situation improves there, I want to go back home. My motherland is there, you know? That's all.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
As the U.S. Open tennis tournament continues this week in New York, we turn to a conversation Amna Nawaz had there with tennis legend Chris Evert. Evert's win-loss record in singles matches is the best of any pro player, male or female, in history. But perhaps her toughest match is taking on ovarian cancer, often known as the silent killer.
This is where, I mean, you must have so many memories from here as a teenager.
I did.
Majors here.
I won.
Yeah,
six times.
Chris Evert dominated women's tennis in the 1970s and 80s. Her career stats are staggering. She won a record 6 U.S. Open titles, tied only by Serena Williams.
Madame Chris Evert Lloyd.
7 French Open titles, 18 major championships at all. She became the first player, male or female, to win 1,000 singles matches. And to this day, she holds the record for the second most career wins, behind Martina Navratilova. Evert grew up in a tennis family in Florida. Her dad taught all the kids to play on public courts. Now 67, and herself the mother of 3 sons, Evert spent most of her life in the white-hot spotlight. She became known for her tough, seemingly unemotional outer shell. But nothing, she says, could have prepared her for the loss of her sister, Jeannie Evert Dubin, who played on the tour with Chris for a while. Jeannie's ovarian cancer was detected late. She lived for 2 more years and died in 2020. Jeannie had tested negative for the harmful variant of the BRCA1 gene, but her blood was stored in a lab in case knowledge or data of new variants became available and as genetic testing evolved. 2 years after her death, Jeannie's blood tested BRCA positive, a warning bell for possible ovarian or breast cancer predisposition in the family. A call from her doctor took Chris Evert's life down an unexpected path. Ovarian cancer, but caught early, stage 1C. Today, Evert is back courtside as a commentator for ESPN, coaching and mentoring the next generation. We talked about her journey, her health, and what's ahead.
It's been 3 months since you finished your chemotherapy. How are you feeling today?
I'm feeling a lot better than 3 months ago. Let's put it that way. I mean, as time goes on and I'm able to get a little more energy, exercise a little bit more, I'm feeling better and better.
I think a lot of people know chemotherapy is brutal. How did you get through it?
Andy, my former husband, took me to all 6 chemos. And, you know, he was really supportive. I had a little nausea and fatigue. Not tiredness, but fatigue is a different feeling. I had that for like 5 days. And then I would have 2 weeks of feeling okay. and I could go to my tennis academy and coach, and I could do pretty much normal things. Yeah. So I feel very lucky.
Lucky not only because they caught her cancer early, but because they caught it at all.
The geneticist called and said, we retested Jeannie's blood and another variant has come up, and now she's BRCA positive, so you're going to have to go take the BRCA test. And so all of our siblings took it. I went the next day and took the BRCA test, and 10 days later discovered that I was positive. I went to the doctor and he said, okay, you have to have a hysterectomy. You don't need the reproductive organs, so yeah. The best thing, the safest thing, is just to get everything out. I encourage any woman not to be afraid of having a hysterectomy. But what happened was surprising after that. My doctor called me 3 days later and said, we are really shocked about this, but our findings are that you had ovarian cancer and you had cancer in your fallopian tubes. And I was like, whoa, but I didn't even feel anything. And that's why this is an insidious, ugly cancer, because you don't feel any effects whatsoever. And many times when women are diagnosed, they're already in stage four.
You have just gone through a full hysterectomy.
Yeah, yeah.
What are you thinking?
I think I just called on my sister's strength. 4 or 5 days later when I got the call, my doctor's going, oh, good news. So, I mean, I was so relieved. But I got a second opinion. So right now they're looking at 90 to 95% chance that the cancer will not come back.
90 to 95?
90 to 95 chance.
What's it like for you to say that number?
I wish it was 100%, but I feel very grateful. Because of my sister's death, I'm alive.
Your sister was diagnosed so late, and she lived for another 2 years, I believe,
yes,
after that. Do you feel like you got to say everything to her you needed to say?
No, I don't think you ever feel that way. She was like the wind beneath my wings, you know, that song. And she was so proud of me and supportive of me and never envious or jealous. She was just a wonderful sister, and I wish I could have told her more. But, you know, sometimes when somebody's really sick, that's not the time to tell them, because then they start to feel worse. They know it's the end. But I think she knows. I mean, I talk to her every day, and I think she knows that now.
What's one thing you wish you could tell her today?
That I would tell her? Oh, God, you just know how to ask these questions. Oh, my God, I'm sorry. I talk about this so much, and I've never cried like this, but I just can't believe how strong she was, and that she never complained, and she had ports and she had incisions all over her body, and she was down to 80 pounds, and I saw her go through this, and she would either be quiet or she'd try to muster up a smile.
You're making me cry now too.
No, it's good. I mean, I want to be emotional.
This vulnerability is something Everett spent decades shielding from public view.
I went back and I read some of the earlier coverage of your career, the way the mostly male press corps, I think, would talk about you and write about you. And there were photographers saying, oh, she's impossible to take a good picture of because she never smiles. And they gave you labels like Ice Princess.
Sure. Look, when I grew up and started playing on the tour, I was 15 years old. The more I read that, the more I got to be that way. I never had the freedom, I think, to develop on my own terms, because I always had the press saying I was somebody else. When I look at the young women today on the court, I see they've come a long way. They're fearless, they're emotional, they have a lot of power, they feel the power, they have a lot of respect.
You look at the way Serena has navigated her career, you look at Naomi Osaka, having conversations around mental health, protecting
yeah.
their own privacy, all these kinds of things. Do you ever look at that and say, I wish I'd had that?
I grew up in the 60s, played in the 70s, there are taboo subjects. You didn't talk about it. You didn't talk about, you know, being gay, and you didn't talk about controversial subjects at all. That was the way the society was, the culture was here in America, maybe here in the world. But now women are just owning themselves and they're empowering themselves, and we're reaching, you know, more and more equality with the men.
How would you describe the place that the game holds today in your life?
I have so many ways of being involved in the game. I mean, I love telling people of me being on center court in the finals, what it feels like, what the pressure feels like. I mean, I love that. I think what I love even more is the mentoring part. You know, I'm very involved with the USTA Foundation. which is all about under-resourced kids, you know, combining tennis and education and giving them a safe place to go to after school, talking to them, mentoring them, seeing the joy on their face. An extension further, I have my own tennis academy right. with my brother, but still, the same applies. The mentoring, I try to explain to them to embrace the pressure, to go with it and not to try to fight it.
Yeah.
You know, I've gotten a lot of wonderful things out of tennis, and now I'm feeling probably better by giving and sharing my experiences and knowing if I'm helping kids. To me, that's the most important thing at this last third of my life.
Analyzing tennis matches and mentoring the next generation at some 250 programs for the U.S. Tennis Association Foundation around the country, Evert remains in the game.
Let's take a larger look now at ovarian cancer in this country. In the United States this year, nearly 20,000 women will receive a new diagnosis of ovarian cancer, and more than 12,000 women will die from the disease. Dr. Carol Brown is a gynecologic cancer surgeon and chief health equity officer at Memorial Sloan Kettering's Cancer Center. She joins me now. Dr. Brown, welcome to the NewsHour, and thank you for joining us. You just heard Chris Evert's story there, learning only of her own risk because of her sister's late diagnosis. But what should the rest of us understand about risk factors? Who should consider themselves at the greatest risk of ovarian cancer?
Thank you so much for having me on this evening and for focusing on this really important topic. And I think Chris Evert's story is really typical and highlights the greatest risk for women who have ovarian cancer is actually family history. As you heard in her story. So the women who are at highest risk of getting ovarian cancer in the United States and around the world are women who have a first degree relative, which means either a mother or a sister with ovarian cancer, or relatives first or second degree relatives with ovarian cancer or breast cancer. So this really ties into Chris Evert's story. In that her having a sister with ovarian cancer. So those are the women that are highest risk, and it shows the importance of knowing your family history. It's really critical.
So Dr. Brown, we know early detection is key. And the American Cancer Society has said that only 20% of ovarian cancers are found at what you consider an early stage. So because there aren't specific symptoms per se, how can it be detected early? What should people know?
So what everyone should know is, again, it really ties back to knowing what are your risks and what you can do to reduce your risk. So knowing your family history really ties into what we've learned in the last decade or so about ovarian cancer and the highest risk being related to family history. It's because the answer is really in your genes. We know that there are mutations that you could have inherited from your parents, and it's not just BRCA1 and BRCA2, but there are four or five major genes that increase your risk for ovarian cancer. And so the best way to diagnose it early is what happened in Chris Evert's situation, where she had what we call a risk-reducing surgery to prevent her from getting ovarian cancer. And it was found that early on, there was a very beginnings, the earliest stages. So knowing your family history and getting that a really critical genetic testing is the most important way you can find it early.
What about disparities when it comes to access to that kind of testing, having and being able to early detect ovarian cancer? Do we see that play out in our health system?
We definitely see the issue of disparities and differences in outcome in ovarian cancer, as we do with many other cancers. And it is really true that one of the really important things to know is knowing about this family history, but getting access to genetic testing and counseling about your genetic risk. Such as Chris Evert had. And we do know, we've done some studies at Sloan Kettering that show that women of color are less likely to have access to genetic testing, less likely to be counseled to get genetic testing. So we really want women and all people to know that if you've got a family history of cancer, ask your clinician about getting genetic testing for cancer.
Dr. Brown, what about men? I mean, if they have a family history, a blood relative who's been positive for the BRCA1 or 2 gene, does that carry a risk for men as well?
So BRCA1 and BRCA2, as with some of the other genes associated with increased risk for ovarian cancer, it's not limited. The risk is not limited to just ovarian cancer. So in BRCA1 and BRCA2, there's also an increased risk for pancreatic cancer, prostate cancer. For some of the other genes associated with increased risk of ovarian cancer, like Lynch syndrome, this is increased risk for colon cancer, bladder cancer. So for men as well as women, for all people that have these family histories of cancers, it is so critical to take advantage of the new technology, to get the genetic testing and counseling done. And then you know that there are things you can do to reduce your risk.
And what are some of those things? Tell us about that.
There's some very simple things, particularly for young women. And it might be surprising for the audience to know, but oral contraceptives, taking birth control pills for just 5 years, cuts your risk of getting ovarian cancer in half. So one of the things that we counsel women who have children who have BRCA1 or BRCA2, they want to know, what can I do? How can I reduce my daughter's risk? Taking birth control pills will cut your risk in half. Another thing is healthy diet, exercise, and maintaining the ideal body weight. This is also something that can really reduce your risk of getting ovarian cancer. But the most important thing is what Chris Evert did, which is to get risk-reducing surgery when you're found to be carrying an inherited mutation that increases your risk for ovarian cancer.
Such important and necessary, useful health information we hope can help a lot of people out there. Dr. Carol Brown of Memorial Sloan Kettering's Cancer Center joining us tonight. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
They're known as monuments officers, and a new collaboration between the U.S. Army and the Smithsonian Institution is expanding their numbers and capabilities in time of war. Their mission: advise military commanders on how to minimize damage to art and other key sites during conflict and aid foreign allies whose cultural heritage is at risk. Jeffrey Brown reports for our Arts and Culture series, Canvas.
I've got the base of the mask right here, secure it.
The National Museum of Pinelandia faces imminent attack.
That's not your show.
Sorry.
Thank you.
And its precious artifacts must be documented, photographed, packed, and moved to a new location within 2 hours.
Careful with that.
Yeah.
Amid quickly changing circumstances.
You're right, Bill.
We've got it.
On the scene to help, the U.S. Army's Corps of Monuments Officers.
You're going to be asked to leave pretty quick here.
Colonel Scott DeJesse.
You have to be able to speak both languages. You have to be able to speak the language of protecting cultural property, and you must also have your military language and understand the processes.
People have one or the other often.
Have,
right?
One or the other, and we're bringing those worlds together in a way that has not been done before.
Pinelandia, of course, is a fictional country. And this was a simulated training exercise in a large hall at the National Museum of the U.S. Army in Fort Belvoir, Virginia. The precious art, gathered from garage sales, flea markets, even dumpster diving. Nothing worth more than a few dollars. But the military officers were the real thing. 21 specialists in art history, archaeology, curation, and other cultural heritage areas. 6 of them international officers here to train and network. The rest, the first cohort of a joint initiative of the U.S. Army and the Smithsonian Institution. Some were reserve officers moving to this new unit, including Captain Sonia Dixon, who's also a doctoral candidate in art history.
I'm passionate about learning about so many different people and their cultures, and I'm passionate about the military. And to get the opportunity to do both of them at the same time and to show people, even if you come from an academic background, you can still have practical ways to help people in the real world.
There were also 6 civilian cultural experts new to the military, having completed physical and other requirements.
That's going to determine how we handle it.
Among that group, Hayden Bassett, an archaeologist and curator at the Virginia Museum of Natural History, where he's been using satellite imagery to document destruction in Ukraine and elsewhere. Now he's also Captain Bassett in the U.S. Army Civil Affairs and Psychological Operations Command.
This is our opportunity to engage with cultural heritage on another level. I've always had a respect for the military. I've never thought I would have the opportunity to take my particular skill set and apply it in a military context and serve in that capacity.
This was not the career path you were on.
Certainly not.
Monuments, man.
It's a new take on an idea that goes back to World War II, popularized in books and film.
So you want to go into a war zone with some architects and artists and tell our boys what they can and cannot blow up.
That's right.
And a group then called the Monuments, Fine Arts, and Archives Task Force, often referred to as Monuments Men. Scholars, soldiers rescuing artworks and other cultural treasures seized by the Nazis throughout Europe. In more recent wars, however, the story has at times been less heroic, most notably in 2003 with the looting of the Iraq Museum in Baghdad, when the military was criticized for failing to heed warnings about the value of the collection and the need to protect it.
That was a moment in time that really galvanized public opinion even more about the U.S. invasion of Iraq, and it really impacted our mission as well.
Corey Wagner, a museum curator, was then an Army Reserve officer deployed to the Baghdad Museum to assess the damage and salvage what was possible.
Walking into those galleries and seeing smashed objects on the floor, even though I was an art museum curator, I didn't really know how to go about evacuating or salvaging objects, and I felt a little bit lost. I wanted to make sure nobody was placed in that position again.
Today, Wagner heads the Smithsonian's Cultural Rescue Initiative, and it was she and Colonel DeJesse who designed the intensive 10-day training program that included courses in forensic documentation and practical problems like drying out damaged artifacts, and briefings from international partners, such as a Ukrainian museum director working to secure objects there. There was a symbolic moment at Arlington National Cemetery with a wreath laying at the tomb of the unknown soldier, including the nephew of a monuments officer killed in action in World War II, and the simulated museum evacuation, which included a jolting moment after one of the role players, acting as a security guard, accidentally on purpose put his foot through a painting.
No, I wasn't expecting anything like this to happen.
I don't even know what a conservator could do to fix this.
That was just one moment of chaos amid constantly changing circumstances.
And then what do we do when the truck comes?
It's not just we're looking at the art objects. Cultural heritage is so diverse, so dynamic, and depending on the culture, it changes. It can be an object, and it can also be an intangible thing.
Oh, all of it, all of it.
As you were, take your seats. Who's in charge here?
For his part, newly commissioned Captain Bassett was suddenly officer of the day in charge of this operation and found himself facing a commanding officer who arrived on the scene to ask some tough questions.
Cultural artifacts, I mean, they're important, but they're number two to human life. That's the priority for our combat forces. Okay, so if you need me to divert combat forces to protect the site, then I need to know that. Is it a company? Is it a platoon? What is it?
Were you surprised by his questions?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah?
Yeah. Part of my job during that was to be able to effectively communicate why cultural heritage is important, why, in this case, the Army or the coalition forces were expending resources to invest in cultural heritage protection.
And that, of course, remains a question. Why and how much should the U.S. care about preserving culture in situations when lives are at stake? Colonel Scott DeJesse, who, by the way, is also a painter in civilian life, is a veteran of cultural protection in a military context, and he puts the issue in military terms.
You're not suggesting that sending art historians out into the battlefield will win victories?
Are you? I would say it's a strategic imperative. The part that we're moving into is the not only a justification for doing it, but a validation for doing it. To validate the success for the mission. If the commander says our lines of effort are to build partnerships, strengthen our partnerships with the host nation, well, we're the experts that know, hey, this is how you build a partnership, by working, by protecting each other's, what our societies mean.
Corey Wagner frames it from the civilian side as a responsibility for museum and other professionals.
How can you ask the military to perform their duties for a treaty about protecting cultural heritage if we don't tell them what cultural heritage is? We're teaching them how to do it, not just why they have to do it.
Captain Hayden Bassett.
The training program's end was marked by a pinning ceremony for these official newly minted Monuments officers, now ready to deploy as needed around the world. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown at Fort Belvoir in Virginia.
It's redefining the U.S. military. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening for all of us at the PBS NewsHour. Thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular's goal has been to provide wireless service that helps people communicate and connect. We offer a variety of no-contract plans, and our U.S.-based customer service team can help find one that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Jim and Nancy Bildner, and Kathy and Paul Anderson. The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.